Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Carefor Virtual Safe at Home Gala. Thank you for taking the time to join us this evening to recognize and celebrate some of the most vulnerable people in our community and those who have helped them through this very challenging year. I'm your host, Eric Fage. I'm also the host of Operation Support Local right here on Rogers TV, and we've got an amazing program for you tonight. Tonight, you'll hear stories of people in your city, stories of community, compassion, and resilience. We also have special guest appearances by Ottawa Mayor Jim Watson, Governor General Julie Payette, renowned local culinary author Margaret Dickinson, and we'll even sing along to holiday favorites with local crooner Sean Marino. Tell you how challenging this past year has been. We've been distanced from our loved ones and disconnected from our lives. We've all been living with the risk and effects of COVID both physically and emotionally. For people living with a physical ailment or cognitive illness like dementia, these times have been like no other. More socially isolating than ever. Despite the hardship, there are also good news stories to share, stories that might not make it to the papers. Tonight, we want to share some of those powerful stories with you. At the heart of these stories and our city's response to COVID-19 is Carefor, a local not-for-profit charity that has been helping our seniors for over 100 years. By offering home health care and community support programs across Eastern Ontario, they are helping people get the care and support they need where they want it. At home. Carefor is their lifeline. During challenging times like these, the power of communities is often put to the test. In each of us is strength and compassion. Tonight we will share some of these stories. They are stories of your neighbors, friends, and loved ones. They're the stories of some of the most vulnerable people in your community. Stories of the generation that took care of us when we needed it the most. And how Carefor staff and supporters have come together to keep our seniors safe through this difficult time. Our first story tonight is about Lois Fraser Blakeney, an 85-year-old woman who lives in Ottawa's West End. She has been receiving home care support from Carefor for 3 decades and understands better than anyone its value. As she says, she wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Carefor.
I wish that people were more informed about the importance of home care. What it means to the individual they're helping, what it means to society in general. Because if they didn't have PSWs doing the work, who would do it?
There's a lot of things that these girls do to enhance our life.
They're able to manage with our help. And Lois is able to instruct us quite well as to what she would like and what she wants. So that's very helpful to us so that we can provide proper care.
I had an accident many, many years ago which left me a quadriplegic. I was in a wheelchair for 30 years. When I left the nursing home, they thought I was totally out of my tree. So I've had home care since 1986. When I first moved into the apartment, I was just learning to walk again. Ed and I weren't married then. So if it wasn't for the home care services, I literally wouldn't be in an apartment. I wouldn't be able to do what I do or live the life that I do live. And that's why, to me anyway, it is so blessed and important. Because God help us, nobody wants to go to a long-term care if they can avoid it. No one.
My relationship with Lois has grown over the years, and we share things like recipes and cooking things.
It seems to brighten her up a little bit because they sit there and they chat a lot, you know.
I don't know what I would have done, because she doesn't only just help me pull up my stockings, she sometimes brings me my humor too.
You can tell that home care is improving their life as soon as you walk in the door, because they're at home and they're relaxed and they're doing their own thing. I'll come in and Lois might be having a cup of tea or coffee and some toast.
In the morning we get up early and we wait for the girls. you're looking at the, oh, be here in 10 minutes, you know? You'd be here in 5 minutes, you know?
If it weren't for Heather coming in, he would have to put my stockings on every morning. He would have to help me take a shower. He'd have to help me get dressed to a degree.
While I'm here, it takes some of the pressure off him and he can do his own thing. He has his own routines, his own exercises to do, or even laundry. He takes the laundry down while I'm here so that somebody is here safe with Lois if she needed anything.
So it takes a little load off of me and gives me a chance to do some of the housework around here.
I'm fortunate. Ed and I got married a few years ago. He's here now all the time. He does a lot of things that I can't do. But I still depend on that personal support worker. And so does he.
I will admit that story hits close to home. My father suffered a heart attack and three strokes over the last almost decade now. And his last stroke put him in that position where he is also one of these vulnerable people that we're discussing today. Without his caregivers who are there Monday through Sunday, each and every day, he probably wouldn't be in the position he is in today. He's come such a long way where his left side was completely compromised. He's got a lot of that movement back, and that is thanks to his caregivers. And more importantly, his caregivers aren't just there for his cognitive and physical rehabilitation. They've also become members of our family and become members of his social group. And of course, during isolation, that's become more important than ever before. We've seen what's happening in long-term care homes, and we don't want our loved ones in hospital hallways. Safe at home is where our loved ones want to be and where they deserve to be. This holiday season of giving, our community has the power to make a difference in the lives of thousands of people and their loved ones, especially during this time of heightened social isolation. Helping local seniors stay safe at home has never been more important. By supporting Carefor, you are supporting the most vulnerable in our community get the quality care they deserve where they and their loved ones want to receive it. This is not new for Carefor. They've been delivering this type of care to Ottawa residents for 123 years. They've been there for our parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents, and will be there for us and our children when we need them. Now, we would like to introduce you to Carefor's board chair with a message of welcome.
Hello, my name is Norma Strachan, and I'm privileged to be the chairperson of Carefor Health and Community Services. I'd like to wish you a happy holiday and tell you a little bit about what we're doing here in Ottawa to keep people safe at home this holiday season. We have hundreds of people here in the Ottawa area that we're helping to support who are living with various stages of dementia. Many of these people are quite isolated. We also would normally have day programs that they could go out to, but right now we have some wonderful virtual programming that we've been doing. We're very proud of our care providers who are also going in and helping these families in this very difficult time. This may be the only contact that they have with the outside world. I really hope that you'll sincerely think about making a donation to help us help seniors this holiday season throughout Ottawa. Thank you.
As they say, it takes a community. Through donor support, you have created new Carefor programs for people living with dementia, allowed Carefor staff to access more opportunities to enhance their skills, ensured Carefor staff and clients had personal protective equipment, and ensured seniors who couldn't afford to attend programs were able to. Their new initiative, Virtual Carefor at Home, will help increase the role of digital tools in home care and support services so clients can stay safe at home while keeping well connected with Carefor staff and services. COVID has affected each and every one of us in some shape or form. Life seems to have come to a screeching halt, but for people suffering with an illness like dementia, each day is more of a challenge than the last. Before the lockdown, we got a chance to speak to Kevin Green, whose wife Karen was diagnosed with young onset dementia more than 3 years ago. In this story of love, compassion, and resilience, he shows us how even dementia can't erode the loving bond between them. When asked how you care for someone living with dementia, Kevin had the perfect answer.
You love them. A little bit of love goes a long way. A little bit of compassion. There's still a warm feeling person in there. I think our relationship is pretty strong. We love each other. She's my sweetheart. I like being with her. I like it when we can do stuff together. Always make the heart-shaped waffles. That used to be a big deal. I always try to find something that we can do that we like together.
He's a nice guy.
There's lots of good stuff there, and you need to focus on it because there's lots of stuff that isn't. So yeah, if you spend your life dwelling on that, then you're gonna be unhappy. And happy goes a long way.
I'm happy most of the time.
Yep, I'm happy when you're happy. Karen's very aware of what she has trouble with, and it's really hard. We make light of it, but it's important to understand. You know, it might be frustrating for me, but it's got to be a whole lot more frustrating for her. And if we can't remember the names of the songs, we'll make our own up. Karen likes music, don't you? Isn't that your favorite thing?
That's my favorite thing.
Yes.
I tell them sometimes, I go, when they're getting ready to do stuff, and I said, hey, it's better. Something.
I've been trying to learn some songs that I
can. Oh, he's good.
That I can do on the guitar or the ukulele or something like that we can sing along to, because Karen really likes that. Good for me too, it's cathartic. Being a 24/7 caregiver is wearing.
Can't be there
you
all
can't
the time.
Be, there's just not enough energy, so it's really important to have the support of organizations like Carefor and to get some respite and to have somebody I can talk to. Generally, people pull back. People say the right things, but it winds up being pretty lonely. A pretty lonely journey. And if not for outfits like Carefor and the various programs that are put on, it would be unbearably lonely. It's just a good culture. I think Carefor is doing something right. There's a lot that a lot of other people could learn from that.
The program Karen attends is one of 5 Carefor Adult Day programs for people living with dementia. These programs are essential in not only slowing the progression of the disease, but supporting the care partners who give so much to keep their loved ones at home with them. COVID has had an impact on these programs, but it hasn't stopped them. Carefor staff have moved them online to continue to engage and connect with clients and care partners. Programs for people living with dementia are sustained thanks to donor support. Care partners are truly the unsung heroes of the care industry. This is how they give, and this is how you can give. If you're able to, please consider a donation to help care partners in our city. People are standing by the phone if you wish to make a donation. No one understands the impact of COVID-19 in our city like Mayor Jim Watson. Knowing the value home care services have on people's lives, he declared the first 2 weeks of October 2020 as Carefor Safe at Home Weeks. We're very fortunate to have Mayor Watson joining us today with a message of resilience.
Hi, this is Jim Watson. Carefor Health and Community Services is celebrating its first virtual Safe at Home Gala. So while we can't get together in person, I'm happy to send a message to all Carefor staff, clients, and their loved ones across Ottawa, wishing you a safe and healthy holiday season. To Carefor staff, thank you for your courage and compassion as you continue to connect with and support those in our city who need it the most. COVID-19 has affected us all, but none more than those whom you support. To Carefor's clients, I wish you health and happiness this holiday season. I hope you and our loved ones are able to get together, even if it's by phone or other video calls, as well as possible. The City of Ottawa is thinking of you through the holidays. And to the caregivers, we recognize all you are doing for those you love. You are the unsung heroes of our healthcare system, and ensuring seniors stay safe at home and out of hospital and long-term care is because of all you do. Thank you and happy holidays.
Thank you, Mayor Watson, for that profound message and your best wishes for Carefor staff, clients, and their families. So now, everyone, with the holidays around the corner, we thought we'd spread some holiday cheer as part of our special. Luckily, we have local singer Sean Marino to lead us through some holiday favorites.
You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Making a list, checking it twice, is gonna find out who's naughty or nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping, and he knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. Sleeping, and he knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming. I hear the big fat man with the long white beard. He's coming to town.
Thank you, Sean, for a great rendition of a holiday favorite. Carefor's programs don't just include home care services. They span far beyond, reaching out to another vulnerable population in our community. A little-known Carefor partnership with Inner City Health and Shepherds of Good Hope is helping build a better future for many of our city's homeless during this time of great need. Programs offered like the Managed Alcohol Harm Reduction Program are their homes. The compassion the program's staff offer is a catalyst that helps people turn their lives around. Here's a look into the impact of this essential service in our community and one woman who sees a brighter future because of it.
Communities have the ability to solve its most complicated problems, mostly a case of bringing people together to find out what as a community we can do to care for ourselves and each other, and that's where the best and most innovative solutions come from.
Carefor provides client care workers and does all the scheduling actually for all the programs in Ottawa Inner City Health. So we schedule right now approximately 3,000 hours a week of client care workers across 11 different sites. And then we add another additional 4 sites where we schedule RPMs for Inner City.
You know, COVID has really assaulted people's mental health. It has really assaulted their sense of community and their sense of belonging. And we're working with a population for whom those have been problems their whole life. And they were finally in a situation where those things were really being addressed. And so to take them back to a place, you know, a place that they've come from, something that they've escaped from, is really, really challenging. It really is possible for people to have the life that they dream of. And I think that when you see people who are homeless, people who are suffering from severe and persistent mental illness, people who are living with overwhelming addiction, it's hard to imagine that a happy life is in their future. And I think that one of the things we've been able to prove with our partnership and with the work that our clients allow us to do with them is that a happy life is not just possible, but it's probable. And it really is a great privilege to be allowed to do that work.
I was lost. Like, I was grieving, then I was angry, then all this stuff happened. It's like I started losing people just like that. I was in a bad place. How can you lose your dad, your best friend? Since I was born till now, I was so caught up with him and like just make sure he's okay. I was expecting me to like, I didn't care about anything. Started drinking too much to numb the pain, you know? Actually just have that mentality that like, everybody's bad just because they're there. No, it's not. Some people actually have a choice. I have a choice to go back home. But I can't because I need to manage my alcohol.
Saving lives makes me feel like I achieved to help somebody live another day. Say they don't think that there's anybody that cares. We show them the empathy. We try to arrange them with the program that suits them. We try and understand that what they need is us and show them that we're there for them.
Just because I've been here for 6 months, I'll tell you something. The staff really care and treat you as in like someone that has a problem. It's like you're their own family.
Vulnerable people in the community, such as people who have no home, no relatives close to help them, nobody to talk to them, or they feel like they're alone in this world.
I came here with my wallet, one jacket and some shoes, and nothing else. They gave me a bed.
They are part of us in the community, they're humans, and we need to make them understand that they cannot just say, hey, no one cares. There's a lot of people that care, like myself and my teams. We show them the compassion and empathy.
As far as my journey goes, like, I'm trying to help myself, right? My life is changing because of them. This thing is making me happy right now.
Someone who came in with nothing, and gradually they gain their self back through our services.
They're just thinking, oh no, someone needs a fix. It's not everybody is like that.
Any one of us can wake up one day and not know where we are, or what we're doing, or why we're here.
This partnership has been supporting people in Ottawa for 10 years, but Carefor services have been around since 1897. You may not know that Carefor was originally known as the Victorian Order of Nurses. More than 15 years ago, Carefor in Ottawa, Eastern Counties, and Pembroke-Renfrew County changed their name to Carefor. Despite the name changes, their history of helping people in need has deep roots in our community. Started by a small handful of compassionate women, Carefor has grown to one of our region's biggest and most respected healthcare and social services agencies.
When Canada faced a shortage of healthcare professionals in remote areas in the 1890s, a team of extraordinary women stepped up to the plate. Lady Aberdeen, the wife of Canada's Governor General at the time, helped form Canada's first national community nursing and healthcare organization, known as the Victorian Order of Nurses. The Ottawa branch of the VON started with two nurses, who traveled by horse and buggy to attend to the sick and the poor in their homes. During a time where women were largely expected to stay home and raise their children, VON nurses wanted to serve their communities, giving back to those in need. The nurses became known not only for their blue uniform and black bags, but also for their professionalism and exceptional quality of care. By 1920, the charity's services expanded to include child and social welfare visits. And during the Great Depression and the Second World War, the VON increased their free nursing visits, focusing on delivering quality care to those in need. VON nurses were a lifeline for thousands in the community. And when the Champlain region rebranded under the name Carefor Health and Community Services in 2006, the women at Carefor continued that legacy. As our services expanded to include more in-home care and community support services, women have been a driving force behind its success. Their work has shaped the organization as a leader in home care services in Ottawa and beyond.
Interestingly, the Governor General of Canada at that time was largely to thank for the creation of a service that has impacted millions of families nationwide. Our current Governor General, Her Excellency, the Right Honourable Julie Payette, is here with us this evening with a special message of thanks and support.
Hello, bonjour. My name is Julie Payette, and I am the Governor General of Canada. Welcome to all of you tuning in to the very first Safe at Home Gala, supporting the programs provided by Carefor Health and Community Services throughout Eastern Ontario. What you do every day, you, the supporters and the volunteers of Carefor, is so important. But even more so these days, as we still battle the COVID-19 virus, your role has taken on an even more significant meaning. Speaking of the virus, you may have heard that reliable vaccines are on their way. This is welcome news, and we will soon see an end to this unprecedented sanitary crisis. Meanwhile, at Carefor, you have stepped up to the plate, adapting your services and the way you work in order to help Canadians, particularly vulnerable and elderly people, stay healthy at home. And you provide more than just care for the body. You nurture the mind, helping those who are isolated to stay connected, well supported. Throughout Carefor's long history, which dates back nearly 125 years, you have always answered the call of service. You've not only been generous, but you've also been generously supported by the community around you, who recognize and appreciate the essential service that you provide. I would like to take this opportunity to thank you, everyone at Carefor, for what you do. I hope you realize how much comfort you bring and how your actions make a difference in the lives of people in your communities. We are inspired by your resilience, and we owe you a debt of gratitude for your dedication to others. As you celebrate your achievement during this virtual gala, take time to reconnect and exchange with old and new friends, and be proud of who you are. I wish you all the very best. Take good care, and please stay safe.
All right, now let's get back to the music. How about another Christmas classic? Sean?
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the treetops glisten and children listen to hear a sleigh bells in the snow, the snow. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, with every Christmas card I write. May your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be white. I said I'm dreaming of a white, oh, Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the treetops glisten and children listen to hear the sleigh bells in the snow. I'm dreaming of a white, oh, Christmas, with every Christmas card I write. May your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be white. Thank you. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know. May your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be white.
The Dickinson family has quite the legacy in our city. Some of you might remember Larry, who had a distinguished career in Canada's Foreign Service as the former ambassador to Kuwait during the Gulf War. In this heartfelt segment, his loving wife, award-winning culinary author Margaret, speaks to his legacy and the moments leading to his passing, and how Carefor staff were right by his side during this difficult time for her family.
Larry and I met on the very first day of the very first class of university at the University of Guelph. Larry, wanting a job that would take us abroad, he decided to write the very competitive Canadian Foreign Service exams. 50 were chosen, and Larry was among them. Our assignments took us to Austria, the former Yugoslavia, the former Soviet Union, to the EU in Brussels, Cairo, in Egypt, South Korea, and then ambassador to Kuwait and all the Gulf states, and then on to be ambassador to Indonesia. After Larry retired from the government, at that point he was Assistant Deputy Minister for Security and Intelligence in PCO, he assisted me in self-publishing my second cookbook. He did all the photography and the computer work. That book has won 5 international awards. It's called Margaret's Table. My first book, From the Ambassador's Table, has also won 5 international awards. He also was there beside me for absolutely every public presentation. He was there in the audience to support me. Indeed, I miss him, but I am trying to carry on life as if we were doing it together. Unfortunately, our well-appreciated lives were repeatedly interrupted by cancer. More than a decade ago, he developed breast cancer. Day surgery removed his right breast, but it was Carefor that came to our home for weeks, every single day, to change bandages, do necessary drainage, and other medical procedures. Then, in 2012, Larry had a persistent cough. I insisted he go to the doctor. He was diagnosed with esophageal cancer. Thanks to an extremely remarkable medical team, a 5-year-long series of chemo and radiation treatments, and our determination to remain positive and to live life as normally as possible, he got 5 years, 7 months. It was Carefor that came during that time to do home visits, to detach empty chemo bottles, to check his vital signs, and to do other medical procedures. and also to come anytime, late into the night or during the day, whenever the situation required it. When hospitalized only briefly and death seemed imminent, it was Carefor who worked frantically all weekend to arrange for a hospital bed, relative palliative care equipment, doctor, nursing staff, because they realized that Larry wanted to pass away at home in a place that he loved so dearly. The thoughtful, sensitive, watchful care that Larry was given and the support and discreet privacy that Tanya and I were given are treasured memories. Carefor deserves our support, regardless how much it is or the type of our contributions. We are so thankful for what we were given by Carefor. We truly have to continue to support Carefor services and their programs in our communities.
That is a beautiful story. Margaret's story is among thousands of those who have been impacted by Carefor throughout the years. What makes this story more important, especially in 2020, is that she and her daughter Tanya have decided to give back. They have played an integral part and role during this COVID-19 crisis in equipping Carefor staff with nearly 2,000 cotton masks. As the Canadian lead for Army of Masks, a not-for-profit organization, Tanya has been working with her allies to keep people safe and protected. One of these allies has been the six mask-e-teers. It's the story of six men who had plans for a great Canadian road trip back in May, but as COVID-19 has done to many of our plans, they were forced to cancel. Despite the setback, they decided to stay and volunteer their time for a good cause. Jose Clave Toledo II, an American from the Philippines, and five others have made a huge impact during this time by making tens of thousands of masks for not-for-profit organizations like Carefor. As Tanya puts it, not all heroes wear capes. Some wear and make masks. Despite or perhaps because of the challenges of COVID, people in our community have stepped up time after time, showing us all that we are strong. Carefor wants to thank all those who have stepped forward to help support our most vulnerable seniors this past year. We are all in this together. Now joining us is Carefor CEO Steve Perry. As the CEO for Carefor for the past 3 years, Steve has been part of leading the organization at one of the most interesting times in its history. He is joining us now to shed some light on how Carefor and home care fit into our transforming healthcare system. I'm pleased to be joined by the CEO of Carefor, Steve Perry. Steve, how you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for asking.
Steve, just on a personal note, first of all, how are you and your family? How have you been doing during the pandemic?
Oh, you know, we've been, thanks for asking. We've been faring really quite well in spite of the challenges we're all living through these days. Life could be far worse for sure.
I was just mentioning to you off camera, Steve, that I've had the opportunity of interviewing many members of your team and working with a couple of members of your team as well. And you guys do such a wonderful job at Carefor, and you've put together such a fantastic team. So first of all, hats off for that. And I know how proud you are of them, but I just wanted to let you know that, you know, we get that same feeling in the community from the wonderful work that they do. But, and let's talk about that incredible work that they do, because there are a lot of different healthcare opportunities out there for seniors in particular in Eastern Ontario. What makes Carefor special in your mind, Steve?
Well, for starters, I'd say one of the really great things about living in our region is that there are a number of truly excellent and client-focused organizations, not-for-profit organizations in particular, that are available to provide seniors and their families and their caregivers the supports necessary to help them lead long and healthy and productive lives. I think what helps set Carefor apart as an organization And as a not-for-profit charitable organization at that, is our size, scope of services, and our regional footprint. From a diversity of programs perspective alone, we offer programs and services that range from traditional home care services to retirement care homes, which many don't know about, adult day programs, short stay, 24/7, respite, caregiver support programs, a residential hospice, non-urgent medical transportation, and the list goes on, actually. And so, you know, that is one of the key elements that sets us apart, I think, as an organization in our communities. And I'd say in addition to that, and you alluded to it in your introduction, we've got a tremendously dedicated staff. And we also benefit from the commitment of a legion of volunteers, hundreds and hundreds of people, donating their time and expertise and energy to help support us do what we do. And of course, the generosity of our donors. And so, you know, when I describe what we do or what the not-for-profit sector does for the system as a whole, you know, I describe it simply as being, you know, anything we do as a business is invested directly right back into the communities we serve.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that, and that's why we're doing this program, right, is to reach out and encourage people to donate, because it makes a huge difference in the lives of the most vulnerable in our community. Steve, the other, you know, thing that we've seen is, you know, we've seen a lot of the strengths and unfortunately some of the weaknesses when it comes to our healthcare system. In particular, I'm talking about long-term care. And through that, I think home care has often fallen through the cracks and has not been recognized as much as it should be. Do you still think it's unrecognized somewhat? And is that still a challenge as far as, an organization like yourselves?
Yeah, well, first of all, it's important to note that we're obviously living and working and delivering care and supports in an environment that's, you know, unprecedented, certainly in our lifetimes. And so it's no small task. It's no easy feat for, you know, long-term care, acute care, primary care, any element of the healthcare system is struggling right now. But you're right. We've always felt, and certainly our sector has felt, that home care is largely unrecognized and not well understood, and nor is the community support services sector, which goes hand in hand with the home care sector. And notwithstanding that, statistics show that, and we were talking offline a bit about this, is by far the vast majority of people, young and old, but certainly it's more true of seniors or aging adults, is that the vast majority of individuals prefer to stay and remain in their home, whatever that context is, for as long as they can. People thrive better, they're more comfortable, they feel more secure. And home care and community support services really allow individuals to live truly that life that they prefer to. And it's been clearly evident throughout the pandemic, and even as, you know, the health system's started to go through some transformation, that home care is not well understood, both from a system perspective as well as from a broader community perspective. And so we really hope to change that through opportunities like this and others. And I think that's also in part, you know, because as described, that care is delivered in people's homes. It's not a bricks and mortar based care model, so it's not easier to touch and feel and see, but at the same time, providing care without the constraints of a physical environment allows us to be far more flexible and client focused in many ways in doing what we do. Now more than ever, the disruption that's happened as a result of the pandemic, now more than ever, there are great new opportunities as well for virtual care and support provision and opportunities.
Yeah, and I think it's important, you know, that we recognize that, right? That we recognize that, you know, you and I, right, we're going to be seniors one day, and our viewers, you know, they also, you know, will be seniors one day, our children eventually as well. And so in 10 years' time, we'd love to see a shift in the way that we care for our seniors. And I think an organization like Carefor, you know, is at the forefront of doing that, Steve. I just want to say, you know, on behalf of us at Rogers TV, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it. And again, you've got a wonderful team there.
Thank you so much for saying that. And I really appreciate that support and recognition.
Steve Perry, CEO of Carefor. Steve, thanks so much for joining us, and we'll continue on with the wonderful programming. Again, a reminder, your donations mean so much in the lives of some of the most vulnerable here in our community. Aging is something we all do. It's also something our parents do. No one knows the path it will take, and sometimes things don't go to plan. When dementia visits upon a family, it can be devastating. But knowing you're not in it alone can make a world of difference. For loved ones, the challenge is great, and at some point it can become too great. What happens then? Well, just 20 minutes outside of Ottawa in Richmond, Ontario, there's a place unlike any other in the area. It's a one-of-a-kind retirement home for 16 women living with dementia. And when I say home, that's exactly how it feels.
My parents lived in a home together, and we could see signs. She was going to the wrong car, and she was forgetting things, and she was trying to make up for it, you know, and pretend it didn't happen. And then they moved to a retirement home, and then all of a sudden she'd go from the dining room back to her apartment, and she'd be in the wrong hallway. And you could see that people were saying hi to her, and she wasn't really recognizing them. And you could see it getting worse, and you could see she wasn't happy anymore. She was sad, and she was frustrated. It's not a nice thing for your family to have to deal with. She moved in here just as COVID hit, and it couldn't have been better timing because she needed help. And she's getting the help she needs here. Eventually, she got used to being here. She got used to all the girls here. She got a best friend here. And then we were allowed to do garden visits and window visits. So I would get my dad, and we would come, and we would sit in the garden and have a really nice visit with her. But you still have a fence between you. It wasn't one-on-one. She gets all the help she needs. They're so kind, they're so caring. They help her with everything. They laugh, they giggle. There's no anger. It's the best place she could have come. If it happened and she couldn't come here, it would have been horrible for her, because she didn't have the help she needed where she was, and we couldn't help her. Like, we don't have the expertise. She just flourished here. You could see her come back. She's smiling, she's laughing, she's happy. They keep her busy with crafts, exercise class, bingo, cards, corn toss, sing-alongs, entertainment, all kinds of things. So she wouldn't have got that where she was. And she was too afraid to participate where she was. She thought people would laugh at her. And here she doesn't have that. We know she's safe here. She's happy. When you call, she's giggling and laughing, and she's fine here. You know, this is her new home. This is a great spot for her. There is a place for these people where they can cope, and they can have a fun life still. It's very comfortable here for her. She's got her own room. The PSWs and the nurses are fantastic. They're all very kind. They're now her family.
The one constant you'll see in these videos tonight is caring. It's at the core of what Carefor does. It's hard to show it because of COVID restrictions and masks, but these staff mean so much to the families they support. Carefor staff continue to travel across the community, making sure people are receiving the health care they need, or continue to pick up the phone, checking in on isolated clients, simply to let them know someone cares. These people are in many ways the glue of our city, and you can help them. Donations mean training for staff. They mean equipment to better help them do their jobs. If you can, say thank you to Carefor staff with a donation today. All right, now let's get back to the music. How about another Christmas classic?
I'll be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. Please have snow and mistletoes and presents by the tree. Christmas Eve will find me where the love light gleams. I'll be home for Christmas if only in my dreams. I'll be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. Please have snow and mistletoes and presents by the tree. Christmas Eve will find me where the love light gleams. I'll be home for Christmas if only in my dreams. I'll be home for Christmas if only in my dreams.
Well, it has been a pleasure to host Carefor's virtual Safe at Home Gala. We've heard from people across our city and heard their stories, stories of community, compassion, and resilience. It's been a tough year, but knowing that organizations out there like Carefor are helping us get through it is very comforting. Carefor is a nonprofit that I'm proud to support. That's why we are all here. Please consider a donation this holiday season at carefor.ca/donate or by calling the number on your screen. We thank you for your generosity. And thank you again for joining us tonight. Stay tuned on Carefor's Facebook page to see our prize winners for a delicious food basket prepared by Ottawa's renowned chef Dave Godso of Restaurant 18 and Reef Estate Winery. Stay safe, good night, and happy holidays.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Oh, it doesn't show signs of stopping, and I've brought some corn for popping. Oh, the lights have turned way down low. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Though we finally kiss goodnight, and I hate going out in the storm. And if you really hold me tight, all the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Oh, it doesn't show signs of stopping, and I've brought some corn for popping. Oh, the lights have turned way down low. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Oh, let it snow. All the way home I'll be warm. All the way home I'll be warm. Oh, the fire is slowly dying, and my dear, we're still goodbying. And as long as you love me so, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow, let it snow, let it snow. Let it snow,